you should be able to define cerebral palsy, what are the important causes, and you should be able to tell few classifications, and you should be knowing about clinical manifestations and important differential diagnosis and what's the principle of management. Definition: cerebral palsy is a static encephalopathy. Static means non-progressive problem of the brain, and it is defined as a non-progressive disorder of movement and posture. In fact, it's a motor problem often associated with mental retardation, seizures, speech and vision abnormalities due to non-progressive damage sustained by the growing immature brain. It may be either antenatally or natally or postnatally. So this definition is very important. See, this the important word here is non-progressive. What do you mean by non-progressive? See, suppose if the victim has hemiplegia, it will not become triplegia or quadriplegia. It will remain as hemiplegia only. Or if he has diplegia, it will remain as diplegia only. But what is that? Not necessarily unchanging. See, the brain is growing. So during evolution, there may be some change in the degree of motor problems. Like if the patient undergoes good physiotherapy, his hemiplegia may become better. Or if he doesn't do anything, then this hemiplegia may worsen, in the sense it may develop into contractures, etc. So that is a word, not necessarily unchanging, but it's a basically a non-progressive disorder, and often associated with all these mental retardation, seizures. The percentages I will be telling you later. Okay, and what is it due to? It is due to non-progressive damage sustained by the growing immature brain. So most of the brain growth, or 80% of the brain growth, occurs in the first 2 years. That's why usually we use the word cerebral palsy for any damage which occurs till that age. See, if the child, 5-year-old boy, gets encephalitis and remains with some sequelae of it, we use the word encephalitis sequelae. We don't use the word cerebral palsy there. Whereas 6 months baby meningitis and gets meningitis, and after that remains with some sequelae, we use the word cerebral palsy due to meningitis sequelae. Okay, so that's important thing about definition. Okay. Next, we'll move on to the prevalence. It was first described by John Little somewhere more than 150 years back. He was an orthopedic surgeon. In fact, he described the diplegic variety. That's why sometimes cerebral palsy is also known as Little's disease. The prevalence is around 2.5 per 1,000 live births. The incidence also around 2 to 4 per 1,000 live births. So with our better NICU care, we expect the cerebral palsy to come down, but it is not happening, because with our better care, the babies who were earlier destined to die, like 600 gram, 700 gram, they are all surviving now, but sometimes at the cost of going in for cerebral palsy also. So that's why even the prevalence incidence also is remaining static. Coming to the etiology, we don't know the exact etiology, but there are many hypotheses. In fact, the perinatal factors, earlier it was said that all cerebral palsies are due to birth asphyxia, and they even started showing the obstetricians. But now we know that the contribution of birth asphyxia is around 10%. So even prematurity, low birth weight, they are all risk factors. Intracranial bleeds, kernicterus, that is bilirubin deposition in the basal ganglia, malformations of the brain, even congenital infections, or even meningitis in the first few years. So all those things can contribute to cerebral palsy. But with all these things, there are in 20 to 30% of patients, there is no apparent cause. Coming to the pathogenesis, so it may occur in a different way in each individual. The reason is we don't know what happens in the brain. Okay, so it also depends on when it occurs, what's the extent of damage, all those things. So based on this, we have few important neuropathological varieties like selective neuronal necrosis, that is some area get necrosed in the brain, or injury around the parasagittal area in the brain, periventricular leukomalacia, status murmuratus, that is involvement of the basal ganglia area, hypermyelination that occurs, focal or multicystic encephalomalacia, that is again brain injury. Let us come to classifications. So when we don't know the etiology, we are bound to have many classifications. See, even in PEM, when we don't know the etiology, we have one dozen classification there. Of course, here we don't have one dozen, at least some four or five classifications. Let us see what are they. Based on the physiological aspect, so we can say spastic cerebral palsy, ataxic cerebral palsy, athetoid cerebral palsy, atonic cerebral palsy, tremor type, mixed type, and based on the anatomical involvement, you can say it as monoplegic or diplegic, hemiplegic, triplegia, quadriplegia, double hemiplegia, okay, like that. Okay, we can say hemiplegic cerebral palsy that way. Based on the etiology, either it is prenatal or natal or postnatal, so the usual contributors are infection, metabolic causes, hypoxia, even genetic issues. Then functional classification, depending on the limitation of activity, we say class 1 as no limitation of activity, class 2 slight to moderate limitation, class 3 moderate to great limitation, and class 4 as no useful physical activity at all. Then we have one gross motor function classification system that usually the physiotherapist, they use this. It has got 5 levels based on the limitation of movements and wheelchair mobility, etc. It's mainly important for physiotherapists. But practically, when a patient comes, we try to club some 2-3 classifications together, something like, say, spastic hemiplegia or spastic diplegia. So this is the important, you can say, motor syndrome classification, or based on the clinical manifestations classification. We have spastic hemiplegia, spastic diplegia, spastic quadriplegia, athetoid type, ataxic type. These are all important ones. Okay. Of course, there can be a mixed variety also. So what are these? See, what do you mean by hemiplegia? Half the body is involved. And what is diplegia? Both the lower limbs are involved here with minimal affection of upper limbs. In fact, diplegia is a typical variety seen only in, it's a word described in cerebral palsy only. Otherwise, you say it as paraplegia. But in cerebral palsy, we don't use the word paraplegia because it's not only limited to the lower limb, there is minimal affection of upper limb, something like they may have difficulty in writing, etc. And this is a quadriplegia, all the four limbs are involved, and these are all dyskinetic or athetoid variety, and ataxic, where there is cerebellar involvement. Again, the same thing, hemiplegic variety, diplegic variety, and quadriplegic variety. We'll take up one by one now. Spastic hemiplegia, what's the etiology? It is more commonly seen in premature babies, or when there were twins and one vanishes. So these are all some of the possibilities. and the pathology could be parasagittal injury or focal ischemic necrosis. Coming to the clinical features, see, this is a hemiplegia, so there is decreased movement on affected side and fisting of one hand. See, when the babies are born, they will have both the hands fisted, but usually by 2-3 months they slowly open up their hand. But if one hand is still continued to have fisting, that's the time mother is worried. That's the time it gets noticed also. The tone may be more on that side. Then early hand preferredness. Usually hand preferredness comes by 2-3 years. If any child develops hand preferredness earlier than 1 year, it's definitely abnormal. That means you have to see what is problem in the other side. Walking is usually delayed, usually one and a half to two years, and once they start walking also, they will have typical circumduction gait of hemiplegia. And what do you think about this? Is it a UMN or LMN problem? CP is an upper motor neuron problem. So deep tendon reflexes are exaggerated. Whatever may be the variety of cerebral palsy, usually deep tendon reflex. Next, spastic diplegia. In fact, this was typically described by Little. The usual etiology is preterm baby who has developed periventricular leukomalacia. What are the features? Delay in achievement of sitting balance or even crawling, and how they move forward. Okay. Just imagine your both the legs are tight, then how to move forward. Okay, you may have to use your upper limb for that. So this looks like commando crawl, and or they have to shuffle with their bottom. So, and what are the what about the tone? Okay, usually they will have spasticity by 2 years, and if you hold the child vertically, the lower limbs go for scissoring. They cross each other. That's mainly because of increase in adductor muscle tone. And when they start walking, they will have toe walking, and fortunately the intelligence is usually normal. Again, the spastic diplegia, you can see that scissoring here. Coming to spastic quadriplegic variety, the etiology are severe birth asphyxia or any significant brain injury. The pathology are multicystic encephalomalacia, parasagittal cerebral injury, CNS malformations. In fact, these are the ones who are severely handicapped, but fortunately the amount to around only 5 to 20% of cerebral palsy. Why they are severely handicapped? Because of frequent occurrence of mental retardation, seizures, all four limbs involved. There may be persistence of primitive reflexes. They may have feeding difficulties due to supranuclear bulbar palsies. In fact, there is an extensive brain damage. What about tone? Increased tone. And what about the deep tendon reflexes? Deep tendon reflexes are exaggerated. Then coming to athetoid or dyskinetic variety. So in the quiz, they can ask you the commonest cause for athetoid CP is carnicterus, or carnicterus causes what type of CP? Athetoid CP. Okay. And of course, even asphyxia can cause to some extent. What are the clinical features? Slow writhing involuntary movements as athetoid movements. Okay. They can have speech affection, high tone deafness, is mainly because of bilirubin encephalopathy. Intelligence is usually normal. Deep tendon reflex are it's a basically extra pyramidal variety. So deep tendon reflexes is usually normal. Coming to ataxic cerebral palsy, usually the problems are in the cerebellum. They will have hypotonia initially, slow motor development, even they may have ataxia, in the form of truncal ataxia or titubation, that is head nodding. And if you hold them vertically, the lower limbs go for wide base, whereas diplegic variety will have scissoring. That is one differentiating feature. Now we'll see what are the associated problems or complications with cerebral palsy. Sometime back it was a question, complications associated with cerebral palsy. Okay, and these are the points. See, around mental retardation, around 50 to 75% of the cerebral palsy children have mental retardation, and seizure disorders in 25 to 33%. So they may not present with seizures when they first present to you, but they are more prone for seizures. Hearing and speech defects in around 15 to 20%, especially in athetoid variety, squint, refractive error, behavioral problems, contractures, caries teeth. That's mainly because of poor oral hygiene, and also they have some issues with the enamel development, failure to thrive, skeletal abnormalities, especially scoliosis. Because of increased tone, they can have subluxation of the hip. That's why they recommend x-ray of the hip once in 2 years. So these are all some of the important associated problems. Please remember that all these problems need not be there in all the cases. In fact, there are some cerebral palsy patients who have reached the top level. That's why that word encephalopathy means abnormal brain is slowly being removed now. And even the static, see, subluxation may progress. So even the static word is also now less often used. That's why now the definition starts with, say, non-progressive disorder of movement and posture. When do you suspect cerebral palsy, or what are the early markers, or what are the target signs for cerebral palsy? So any paucity of movement or excessive or disorganized movement, consider cerebral palsy. Stereotype behavior, persistent tone abnormalities, feeding issues, persistent fist or cortical thumb, hyperextension of the head, neck, persistent morose reflex beyond 6 months, early hand preferredness in the first year, or in general, any delayed milestones, one possibility is cerebral palsy. What are the differential diagnosis? See, you have to, in early age, it is little difficult to make a diagnosis of cerebral palsy for sure. See, sometimes you may require repeated follow-ups also. See, degenerative or metabolic CNS diseases also present with similar feature, but usually they are progressive and the patient worsens. Sometimes there is reversal of achieved milestones or regression of achieved milestones. So these are all some of the important features of degenerative or metabolic diseases. Even some of the metabolic diseases or storage disorders will have even organomegalies. Then spinomuscular atrophy. You must have heard about motor neuron disease in adults, where the motor neuron slowly dies. Something akin to that is spinomuscular atrophy in children. Here it's basically a LMN problem. So deep tendon reflexes are decreased or absent, whereas our CP is UMN problem. Congenital myopathies or Duchenne muscular dystrophy, they may have some dysmorphic features. They may have typical features of muscular dystrophy in the form of pseudo hypertrophy, Gower sign, etc. And ataxia. All differential diagnosis for ataxia are DD for ataxic CP. Please don't cross talk. So I have unmuted you all. In case if there is any issue, you can tell me. So when do you suspect CNS disorder? rather than cerebral palsy. See, progressive enlargement of the head. In cerebral palsy, most of the time we will have small head. So if there is if the head is increasing in size, that means there is something getting deposited in the brain. So you suspect something else. Cataract is usually not a feature of cerebral palsy. It may be a feature of some something like rubella, congenital rubella syndrome. Of course, congenital infections in early age will lead to something like cerebral palsy only. Cherry red spots seen in some metabolic disorders. Skin markers, organomegaly, think of storage disorder, decreased or absent deep tendon reflexes, think of LMN problem, sensory abnormalities. Usually cerebral palsy is defined as a motor disorder. So if there is any sensory abnormality, think of something other than cerebral palsy. Coming to diagnosis, good history, physical examination, IQ, visual, auditory assessment, or any, and investigations. You can hear me, no? Please don't cross talk, then I'll have to unmute you all. We'll continue now. Coming to investigation. Diagnosis of cerebral palsy is essentially clinical, but you may have to do some investigations to rule out differential diagnosis, something like MRI, CT scan, or MRI or CT scan. We usually prefer MRI, EEG for diagnosing the type of convulsions, electromyogram or neurosonogram. This may be required, especially to rule out differential diagnosis. MRI may tell you which part of the brain is involved, and it may throw a light regarding the etiology also to some extent. Coming to management, it's a multidisciplinary approach. See, remember this word, okay? So even if you don't know the meaning, so the examiner will know when you say this multidisciplinary approach. What do you mean by this? So it involves multiple disciplines: pediatrician, neurologist, occupational therapist, ophthalmologist, orthopedician, okay, so on. So it is a multidisciplinary approach. Let us study the management under three important headings. The first most important is ambulation. Okay, how to make them ambulatory. Okay? Physiotherapy is the mainstay of therapy for ambulation. So it modifies the abnormal tone and posture in order to elicit desired movements. There are some techniques also, I think may not be very important for you, but still remember the word Bobas techniques, Wostas technique, and of course all may not be able to afford all these therapies. So even indigenous at home, you can try. You can make the child sit in the corner so that ataxia can be minimized. You can put him in that toy rocking horse and all, so that his adductor spasm may become less. You can put him prone on a pillow so that he will try to lift his head. So some of these indigenous techniques can be tried. And drugs like diazepam, baclofen, dantrolene, L-DOPA have been tried. Most of these are skeletal muscle relaxant to some extent. Okay, it makes the muscle more amenable for physiotherapy. Botulinum toxin, okay, controlled botulinum toxin to particular muscle can relax that muscle so that it becomes more amenable for physiotherapy. Of course, you have to be careful regarding the Botox toxicity also. orthopedic management may be required, especially tendinotomy, fasciculotomy, or even removal of the contractures. And there is something called selective dorsal rhizotomy. We'll see what it is later. And even you can go for motorized mobilities, wheelchairs, etc. What is this selected dorsal rhizotomy? You specifically select few of the nerve rootlets and cut that so that the muscles become little relaxed. So then, but it has to be really selected well. So otherwise, you will end up with from spastic motor deficit to placid motor deficit, which may be even more worse. Hyderabad side, they do this surgery often. Okay. There are some of the kids who have undergone some simple procedures like say the 3-4 is selected dorsal rhizotomy, quite well done, and fasciculotomy, etc. Regarding next, communication. So you have to take care of vision, hearing aspect, speech therapy they may require. They may require education in special schools. Of course, everything depends on the associated complications. Even other medical aspects needs to be taken care of, like intractable seizures may be an issue, feeding may be an issue. So all those things need to be taken care of. And of course, they have to be useful to the society, and they have to be self-sufficient also. So rehabilitation. So you have to teach them. You can guide them to Spastic Society of India so that they can share their thoughts, and even they can learn simple occupational therapies like candle making, basket making, etc. So that they can have their livelihood also. So they can reduce the burden on their parents. So what about the prognosis? So what do you all think? So survival, okay, it depends on the associated complication or severity of the complications, like severely handicapped, or severe mental retardation, or frequent occurrence of seizures. Sometimes with status epilepticus, he may have aspiration and other issues. So survival depends on that. Okay, otherwise, there is not much problem with the survival. The next question mother will ask you, do you think my child will ever walk? So of course, you not give one clear-cut answer for that, but it all depends on, again, associated complications and their effort on therapy. But we have certain guidelines here to prognosticate. So independent ambulation is rarely achieved if the sitting balance is not yet achieved 4 years. There is one more slide. What are the important questions? I'll put that, and after that I'll end. Definition of cerebral palsy is one important question. So in VIVA, they can ask you, CP is also known as Little's disease. The classifications of cerebral palsy is important. There are some 4 or 5 classifications. Okay, so just don't be happy with just writing one classification, because it's usually a 5-mark question. What are the associated problems of in cerebral palsy, like mental retardation, contractures, convulsions, etc.? And what's the principle of management of cerebral palsy? It's a multidisciplinary approach, and mainly ambulation has to be taken care, communication has to be taken care, and even the rehabilitation is important. So 6th October is considered as Cerebral Palsy Day.